Dr. Manish Singhal. Dr. Manish Singhal is a professor at IIT from XLRI, XIMB, sorry, XLRI, the famous Management Institute in Jamshedpur. I'll request Aditya ji to take forward the session.
Thank you, sir. Professor Singhal was not able to join the conference because he had some other workshop he was engaged, but he has kindly sent a video. And I just request the audience to just bear with the video quality. There might be some, it might not be that good, but we are trying our best. And in case there is a disconnection, don't worry. We'll get connected and we'll start it again. So just bear with it. And before I start the video, I'll just let the audience know a bit about Professor Manish Singhal ji. So this is a brief background. He's a professor of organizational behavior at XLRI Jamshedpur. He pursued his PhD in behavioral sciences at IIM Calcutta. He has an eclectic profile with qualifications in mechanical engineering, finance, and general management, organizational behaviors, and sociology. And a field experience in the discipline of anthropology, archaeology, journalism, and yoga as a sadhana and therapy. A very unique experience of his. In between his MBA and PhD, he spent 6 years full-time experience as a selfless missionary dedicated to man-making and nation-building. This has provided the breadth of experience to relate to various human challenges and encourages his student to move towards actualizing one's potential. He is the author of Spirituality at Work, a study of Indian nonprofit organization, and has led various anthropological research and documentation studies in Vivekananda Kendra Institute of Culture, Guwahati. So with this introduction, I'll just start the video.
He kindly recorded it last evening only specifically for this conference. So, and he may actually join during the session sometime.
Namaskar to everyone. I thank Dr. Ashish Pandey.
Is everyone able to listen to the voice of Professor Singhal?
I can listen.
Okay, I'll start from the beginning. Thank you. Thank you for the confirmation, Professor.
Namaskar to everyone. I thank Dr. Ashish Pandey and the others who are associated with this Yoga Style conference. In a way, COVID has provided us all with the opportunity of being able to take part in this conference while we are sitting at our own places. Otherwise, for many of us, it might not have been possible to travel all the way to IIT Bombay to take part in this. But then this, again, has come as an opportunity where all of us are here together. And I was quite enthused when I listened to Mukulji in his inaugural session, where he underscored the need of all of us to work upon stuff that is Indian, stuff that is Bharatiya, and that which we have the potential of contributing to the whole literature. And I was thinking that probably if you bring back to your mind the session which was the mesmerizing session which was held by Satbir Singh Khalsa ji yesterday. So there's a whole lot of research which has been done on the physiology of yoga. Physiology of yoga is one which has long been examined. Along with that, if you look at the other sessions as well, so there is some which has been done on the philosophy of it, going back to the literary explanations, the various commentaries that we saw yesterday. And within that, we also saw as to how if you look at the popular kind of translations, or if you look at the so-called Western purists who are looking at the Indic traditions, at the Bhartiya tradition, how they tend to miss the point. So that was another thing that we have seen. So one is the physiological aspect, the other is the literary aspect, and as to how considering the varied sources will probably help us make better sense of our own tradition, of probably increasing our own nishtha in it, our own shraddha about it, and then we will be able to go further. I think there is a fundamental distinction that we need to draw between the Western ways of knowing and the Indian, the Bhartiya ways of knowing. Over there, probably it is likely that we can differentiate, and there is a sharp separation between the person who is conducting that particular study and the subject of the study. Whereas if you look at us, if you look at our tradition, if you look at our heritage, you will realize that the person who is doing it is known as the Acharya. Someone who is demonstrating it through one's own, not only the practice, but also one's regular behavior, is probably the one who is fit to be called the Acharya. And it is in that sense that I feel that there's a whole lot that we need to learn, not only from research, but also from the practices. So from the practices of not only the one who's propounding it, but probably those who are influenced by that particular culture, by that particular philosophy, and is able to demonstrate it in one's own life. And it is in that sense that I move forward with this presentation, which is more on yoga and management, because I teach at an MBA school. I teach at XLRI Jamshedpur, and I've been here for some 14, 15 years now. But what brings me to this particular conference is not my experience over the last 14, 15 years, but the formative experience that I had in Vivekananda Kendra, Kanyakumari. So that is where I was between my MBA and my PhD. So I spent 6 years there. So for 1 year, we took our training in S. Vyasa, what is known as S. Vyasa University today, with Dr. H.R. Nagendra, Dr. H.R. Nagnatma, Dr. Shirley Tallis, we were taught by all of these people there, 94 to 94, precisely. Then 94, I moved to Kanyakumari, and that is where we got, in a way, educated about. Because think about it, most of our education leaves us completely clueless about our own culture. And therefore, that is where I got my training. And after that, I was in Guwahati for 4 years, for 5 years. So till 2000, till I went to IIM Calcutta as a PhD student. So much of what I'm going to do today, much of what I've done in the last 15 years here at XLRI has been based on those formative experiences of those 6 years. And that is where I come to for this particular conference. So the topic that I have today is yoga and management, research and practices. And what I'm going to take you to, so let me take you through the flow of this particular presentation. So I'll begin to examine the typical definitions that we give, which is that for yoga. And because that is more focused upon the Rajyoga, I will try to look at that it is not only the Patanjali Yoga Sutra, but there are a number of other streams of yoga which may perhaps be more amenable to the study of management. Then I'll move towards the obvious and not so obvious research areas, given that I'm supposed to focus both on research as well as practice. So that is what I'll do. And then I'll move into the area of practice. So what I'm going to draw upon over here is the kind of work that I've been doing in my leadership training sessions, not as much into research. That is something that I'm getting into. So there are points from training for practice. So I'll tell them the number of things that we can look at, but in the interest of time, I'm going to look at these two of them. One will be that of emotional intelligence, and the other will be that of leadership. And from there, what is the insight from India which we can leverage for improving our understanding, for deepening our understanding of what is here. Okay? And then finally, the conclusion part of it. So yoga. We would have been informed again and again. All of us would have already been, would already know about it. So Patanjali Yoga Sutra definition for yoga, it starts with Atha Yoga Anushasana. So the idea that we started with there is yoga chitta, vritti, nirodha. And there are a number of ways in which people talk about it, and they also talk about as the kind of sutra thereafter. But primarily what we are focusing more upon is the nirodha, okay? The cessation of chitta vritti. And therefore, if you drop a stone, the ripples which move from there. So likewise, if I start thinking about a particular thing, from there, it is more likely that I'll move somewhere else. And therefore, could I begin to focus and over a period of time become established in it. So Patanjali Yoga Sutra definition. Another definition that we usually give in the yoga circles comes to us from Yoga Vashishta. And manaha prashamanaha upayaha yoga itya vidhiyate. And therefore it is a technique to manaha prashamana. And if you recall when we were talking about Patanjali Yoga Sutra yesterday and we were listening to Dr. Jayaraman, a riveting talk that we heard yesterday, and where he was saying as to how the Western theorists have kind of differentiated between yoga, which was more for mortification. You may recall that particular talk, and as to how within India, within our own tradition, the tapas is also for something which is going to control the mind. And if it is not about agitation, it obviously is not about mortification, but it is more about manoha prashamana upaya. And these are usually the two definitions that we give whenever it is that we conduct our yoga classes, whenever it is that we are interacting with the general populace. But what I wanted to focus upon here is that it is not only the Raj Yoga aspect of it which is important, but there could be many different paths that are available. So I go back to the modern seventh Swami Vivekananda, who at one point of time, he starts his treatise on Raj Yoga with this as the preface. What does he say? He says, each soul is potentially divine. Each soul is potentially divine. And he says that it is a standing label on human nature to term you as a sinner. Each soul is potentially divine. The goal is to manifest this divinity within by controlling nature externally and internally. Remember, you are not inviting something from outside, you are only manifesting that which is already there. So the goal is to manifest this divinity by controlling nature externally and internally. He goes on further to initiate four different parts to it. Do this either by work or worship, or psychic control or philosophy, by one or more or all of these, and be free. And therefore the laudable goal that is there for all of us is that of freedom. What are the different ways that we can go about it? So one particular way could be that of the idea of karma yoga or worship, bhakti yoga. Psychic control, which we have already seen as what Raja Yoga is about, or philosophy, jnana yoga. By one or more or all of these can be free. He says this is the goal of nature. I would argue that as we start looking at these varied ways, a number of directions, even for research, will become possible, which is what I'm going to hear. And I start off with this particular idea that the first one, which obviously for those of us who know about it, is this idea of positive psychology. So there's values in action. The movement started with Martin Seligman, when he was the president of the American Psychological Association, and it has taken different paths. And therefore, there are said to be those basic values. And as to how is it that psychology could be more about moving towards the positive to be able to balance the overt focus upon the negative that was there in psychology all along. If you look at yoga, here also we are focusing upon that which will make your life that much more abundant with grace, abundant with good health. So positive psychology is one. The second aspect which I was saying, so do this, how are we supposed to do this? So do this by work. So the idea of karma yoga. The idea of karma. Okay, and the various definitions that we have, samatvam yoga uchyate, the definition which is given, and can I bring it to my ideal of karma yoga? And in that particular idea of karma yoga, I think there's a very important research avenue which has come up over the last few years now, which is that of psychological detachment. Wherein what they say, that if a person is working at work and then comes back home, might not be as relevant today given the COVID times, given that all of us may probably be at home and be working for it. But there's still, and therefore the research, the kind of papers that have come in, they say that when you come back home and you detach from what you have done over there, then it has got many positive psychological implications for us. I would believe that this particular idea can be taken to its very extreme, where when you and I, when we are engaging in karma, how is it that we convert it into a karma yoga is that if there's a constant psychological detachment, constant psychological detachment, I'm not only doing it at the end of the day in order to feel better about myself, in order to be relieved of the kind of stresses that I've gathered from there. Come to think of it, how is it that we gather stress? All that we do to be able to gather stress is to be able to identify with that which is not true. If we can cultivate that nitya viveka, if we can cultivate the nitya and the anitya, the viveka, the discrimination between that which is nitya and that which is anitya, we will not have that stress to begin with. And therefore, I think a bit of work over there, which is what I said. So one, some are obvious, some are not so obvious. This probably would be an idea which needs to be examined further, which is the idea of psychological detachment. The third one, which is obvious, given that the topic is yoga and management, the third one in which my thesis was also based, which was upon workplace spirituality. Workplace spirituality. And we had examined the idea that there might be quite a few organizations where it might not be possible to be able to practice this. Though realize, because many of the organizations may probably not have the idea of loka sangraha as their basis for business. Okay? And therefore, we are not restricting ourselves only to the for-profit organizations. We are looking at non-profit as well. And therefore, it is about management. It is not yoga and business. Okay? And therefore, when we are looking at workplace, there could be for-profit, there could be non-profit, there could be other organizations as well. And therefore, how is it that we can infuse our daily living by the science of being, which is what spirituality means? And therefore, the third is the idea of workplace spirituality. Yet another idea which we have been trying to develop. So my earlier PhD student and currently my very valued colleague, Professor Kumar Alo, has developed this particular theory of sattvic leadership, which is an indigenous model of leadership. If we go back to Mukulji's session the day before yesterday, Mukulji's session during in the pre-workshop days, in the first session that we had, he was talking about why is it that we are only importing ideas from the West? Why do we not create something of our own? And this is one of our attempts where we have tried to develop this idea, sattvic leadership, completely from Professor Kumar Alok's work, how we are trying to extend it further, and which got published in Journal of Business Ethics in 2017. How is it that we are going to go further? We are going further by looking at these four different examples. We are looking at these four different leaders, which is Mahatma Gandhi from the political arena, APJ Abdul Kalam from the technology arena. We are looking at G.R.D. Tata from the business arena, and we are looking at Swami Vivekananda from the spiritual arena. And we are trying to examine the leadership from the biographies and autobiographies of these four leaders as to whether there are aspects of the leadership which are explained better by one of the more rigorously researched leadership theories today, transformational leadership or that of sattvic leadership. And what we are saying is that a more culturally relevant model may probably be the one which we Indians have delivered on our own. Okay? And therefore, that is one that we are still working on and we are going forward with that. So amongst the many research directions which are obvious. What I'm going to come to now is the field of practice. And in this field of practice, from my extensive...
So we have just stopped playing the video for the moment. Just hold on, please.
Actually, we can continue.
Okay.
Please try once again. Yeah.
Okay.
A kind of experience with the leadership training of spirituality. And we are trying to examine the leadership from the biographies and autobiographies of these four leaders as to whether there are aspects of the leadership which are explained better by one of the more rigorously researched leadership theories today, transformational leadership or that of sattvic leadership. And what we are saying is that a more culturally relevant model may probably be the one which we Indians have delivered on our own. Okay? And therefore that is one that we are still working on and we are going forward with that. So that is, these are the many, the amongst the many research directions which are obvious. What I'm going to come to now is the field of practice. And in this field of practice, from my extensive kind of experience with leadership training for a variety of organizations throughout the length and breadth of this country, there are these two elements which have found favor, which have found favor with many of these practicing executives, many of them with even 35 years of experience. Because people are starved for knowledge from India. And emotional intelligence. So let me give you one of the more widely accepted definitions of emotional intelligence, which is that it is the capacity to reason about emotions and of emotions to enhance thinking. Okay? And therefore, emotional intelligence. How can we be more intelligent about emotions? They go further to say that it includes the abilities to accurately perceive emotions, to access and generate emotions so as to assist thought, to understand emotions and emotional knowledge, and to reflectively regulate emotions so as to promote emotional and intellectual growth. This is the definition which comes to us from Mayer, Salovey and Caruso, 2004. You may recall, Satbir Singh Ji Khalsa also made this idea about regulation, self-regulation. And that is one which I'm trying to highlight here as to how we can leverage our tradition to be able to shed some new light on this. And what is it that I come to? I come to this fundamental idea of Vandhaya Vishya Sangam Muktayai Nirvishya Mana Manaiva Manushyana Karana Bandha Moksha Yoga from the Chanakya Niti may not be known as a typical yoga text, but I would argue that all the literature that he has produced is fundamentally about yoga. So what is he saying? Manaiva manushyanam karanam bandha moksha yoga. So vishyon mein man ko lagana hi bandhan hai, aur vishyon se man ko hatana hi mukti. You may recall that I was earlier saying that it is about the nitya viveka, that which is nitya and that which is anitya. And therefore, from the vishya which are there outside of us, can we get back to the vishayi? Okay? So what is it that we are saying? The idea is the mind verily is the cause of man's bondage and liberation. So how do we move in that particular direction? What we are going to leverage is from the Patanjali Yoga Sutra, the celebrated 33rd verse from the first chapter. What is the insight? The insight is that you and I cannot cultivate both positive and negative emotions simultaneously towards someone. And therefore, what is it that you're trying to do? Remember, the objective is to improve our self-regulation. Okay? And therefore, I will take you to that particular sutra, which is Maitri Karuna Mudito Pekshanama Sutra Dukkha Punya Punya Vishya Nama Bhavanata Chitta Prasadam. Chapter 1, verse 33. The idea being that if you are looking at the various Vishyas that are there, the objects of experience, you should be cultivating these four responses towards them, which will go against what naturally comes up for you and I when we encounter the objects of experience. First, whenever it is that someone is happy, the typical human response, I'm not saying the natural human response, I'm saying the typical human response, the way we get socialized, is that of jealousy. And therefore, from there, could we look at cultivating friendliness towards you? Okay? Next, from there, can we look at dukkha, distress, pain, or suffering? Distress, pain, or suffering. Remember this, that we see somewhere or the other, that is the idea. Didn't I tell you this? And therefore, somehow or the other, the idea of the ego becomes paramount, and from that basis, we try to probably preach to the other or remind him or her as to how he or she has not paid heed to what he had already asked him to do. So from the sukha, maitri towards the person who has sukha, karuna towards the one who has dukha, mudita towards those who have good approaches. Once again, realize whenever it is that I see that there's a punyatma there, somehow or the other, the ego which raises its head, which raises its foot, and then tells you, reminds you, as to how much lesser you are from the person, as compared to the person. So from there, can I be delighted? And the final one, which is that of abhinya, the person who is bad, the person who is evil. And something which finds great favor with the executives that I teach this to, that by and large, most of our interactions, most of our focus is upon that which is not worthy to men. Look at our TV channels, look at our newspapers, look at our page 3 celebrities, etc. Wherever it is that you see, everywhere is very good. And therefore, Patanjali Yoga Sutra reminds us that in order to be able to cultivate a particular state that we come to, what you should be doing towards people of that kind would be that of equanimity. Okay? If you and I were to do that consistently, continuously, over a period of time, we will be able to radiate, we will be able to project what? A consciousness that is calming, that is tranquilizing. Okay, so the chitta prasad is the outcome from there. And many a times people ask me as to what is the way out, right? Because that is something which is internal. That is something which is internal. And therefore, how do I measure myself? Remember, we are talking about managers who are schooled into objectivity, measuring, etc., etc. And I tell them that somehow or the other, what we ought to be looking at, that those so-called typical tendencies of the human mind which come to us, which could be that of jealousy, which could be that of anger, irritation, etc., etc., can we start measuring for ourselves, counting for ourselves, keeping a frequency count of how frequently am I overcome by those typical tendencies? Frequency. The duration of that particular tendency. Okay? Frequency, duration, and finally that of intensity. With what intensity do I go through it? Okay? Over a period of time, if these three aspects are going to come down, I eventually will be able to radiate or project a calming, tranquilizing, clarifying consciousness. So this is one which has found great favor with the executives that I've taught. Another very important point, because this is something which is needed apparently by everyone today, is the idea of emotion. You may recall that in emotional intelligence, I've given you a particular definition. In this particular part here, I will give you a definition which is taken from Northrop's 2010. One of the more established texts on leadership. Okay? What does it define leadership? And House himself had said that there are as many definitions of leadership as there are scopes. Okay? So I'm not advancing my own, okay? I'm leveraging Northouse's definition here. Mary says that leadership is a process. It is not the person, it is not the position, it is a process. Whereby an individual, remember the focus is more on the process, it is not about the person concerned. That person becomes known as a leader, but here the focus is on the process. Whereby an individual influences a group of individuals to achieve a goal. The process of an individual influences a group of individuals to achieve a goal. I think the rest of it may probably be more easily acceptable. The central part here, as far as leadership is concerned, is the idea of a common goal. So it's quite useful. It's quite useful to ask people to list why they move from one organization to another. Okay? As you could well understand, many people would claim that they got a better CTC, they got better opportunities, they got better visibility, they got a place of their choice, they got a project of their choice, or whatever it is, and therefore that is what I asked them, and that is the response when I asked them as to why did they join the organization. organization. And I then asked them as to why is it that the organization employed? Quite a crafty way of getting to my point here. Okay, so why did the organization employ you? So the organization employed you because you wanted job done. They wanted someone with the right skills, etc., etc. So that is the organizational goal. This is your goal. As I list these two, it is immediately apparent that there is no overlap. There is no common goal. Which then leads me to the common goal. Common goal. Meaning that, and I leverage a pretty old reference here, but I said that there could be organizations like the Ramakrishna Mission. Okay, for those of us who have been in touch with the Ramakrishna Mission, what is the motto of Ramakrishna Mission? It says, Atmano Mokshartham Jagati Hitayaj. So, okay, so for the moksha of the self, Atmano Mokshartham Jagati Hitayaj. Okay, so when the two go together, then that person will identify with that goal of the organization and will join the organization. Were I to be focused only upon Jagata Hita, I would probably have gone to an NGO, I would have probably gone somewhere else. But along with that, because I'm interested in my moksha, given the way I understand myself, then I will identify and I will display moral commitment towards the organization. The basis of membership is identity. Okay? Next. The example that I give. The second type of organization that we could be looking at is utilitarian. XLRI for me, yours for you. By and large, the basis of membership is a quid pro quo, give and take. Okay? And therefore, obviously, the basis for membership is what kind of commitment is called for now? That is calculated. Wherever it is that my bread is buttered better, I will lean towards that. I don't identify with you completely. Wherever it is that I feel that I get a better deal, that is where I'll move. So that is the calculative aspect of it. Okay? Third is that, of course, at the other end of the extreme, where people are kept on the basis of fear. Because I'm afraid that if I try to run away from here, right? We recently saw what happened near Kanpur. And therefore, that is why I choose to stay here. Because whenever it is that I will choose to run away from here, I'll be shot dead. The more the person stays there, the kind of commitment called for would be that of alienated. You become more and more alienated from that particular system, the more the time that you spend. Remember, this is not new. This is not new. All of these are breeding commitment, compliance, resistance, respectively. Where is this coming to us from? It's coming to us from Amitai Etzel, a sociologist, 1960, a comparative analysis of complex information. Now, this is where I draw from our literature, wherein I say that while all this may be true, what is it really about the type of organizations? Or is it about the kind of commitment that you have? Is it about your motivation? Meaning thereby that within the same organization, there may be people who are there because of fear. There are people who are there because of quid pro quo. There are those who are there because they identify with the mission of the organization. And therefore, what we need to be doing is probably creating a pie chart of these three components for ourselves. It is easy enough to realize, it is very easy to realize for working executives that obviously they need to be minimizing alienative commitment. They need to maximize moral commitment, increase identification, and probably rationalize calculating. Right? Because that's who they are, that is how they get their work done. So now, when we are looking at increasing identification, how do we go? Which is where I liberate the idea of Akhanda Mandala. Many of us may have heard of that stotra. Akhanda Mandala Dharam Vyaptam Yojana Tatpadam Darshanam Asmi Shri Guru. What is the idea behind this Akhanda Unbroken Mandala Sattva Akar Udashi? The idea here is that all of us are in terms of our identity, it is an ever-expanding spiral. the same individual simultaneously occupies these ever enlarging identities. All of us exist at all of these levels simultaneously, all together. I give this example of the Maruti Suzuki India entity. You know, you may remember that there was a particular horrendous accident which happened there, where a particular DG and HR was burnt alive by the contractual laborers of Maruti Suzuki India Limited. That was great. Why did that happen? Because the contractual laborers were not really very satisfied getting half or one third of the pay for doing the same job as a full-time laborers. And I asked my audience this question, that if you look at Mr. ABCD, I do not give the name. If you look at that particular person, why was he deciding the way he was deciding? Okay? And therefore, was he deciding it because he wanted to save his own skin? Did he want to do it because he had wanted the next promotion or a pat on the back or whatever it is? Okay? So did he identify with I, me, myself? Or did he identify with his HR department? Given that most...